Hi, welcome back. Welcome to Insect Systematics lecture series. Since few previous classes, we were discussing the general characters of orders and economically important families. So for few more lectures, I'll be talking about Polyneoptera orders. In the lecture number 7, I'll be talking about the characters of order Orthoptera and economically important families. So this is the slide which I'm continually putting in order to make sure that the classification given by Christensen and the updated version is clearly understood to you. So superclass or epiclass Hexapoda consists of two unranked groups, Entognathus Hexapoda and Ectognathus Hexapoda. Entognathus Hexapoda consists of class Illipura and class Diplura, whereas Ectognathus Hexapoda consists of class Insecta, which includes true insects. This class Insecta consists of two subclasses, subclass Archaeognatha and subclass Dicondylia. Subclass Dicondylia consists of infraclass Thysanura and infraclass Pterygota, that means winged insects. So infraclass Pterygota consists of division Paleoptera and division Neoptera. Okay, so in the previous lecture, that is lecture number 6, we studied the general characters of order Epimeraptera and Odonata, which do not have the wing flexion mechanism, whereas the all other insects will have the wing bending mechanism, that means they have the ability to bend the wing above the abdomen at rest like this. So they are Neoptera insects, advanced group of insects. So this division Neoptera consists of three subdivisions, subdivision Polyneoptera, Paraneoptera and Oligoneoptera. Okay, so for next 2 or 3 classes, I will be covering the orders, characters of orders and economically important families under each of these orders. Okay, so in the lecture number 7, I'll be talking about the subdivision Polyneoptera, okay, and order Orthoptera. So economically important families of the order Orthoptera. Okay, so order Orthoptera includes grasshoppers, locusts, crickets and catadids. Etymologically, ortho means stride, terra means wings. So this word Orthoptera is derived from Greek word which refers to parallel sided structure of the front wings. So you can see here the four wings are arranged straight, okay, parallel sided. So that's how they are called Orthoptera. Coming to important characters of order Orthoptera, antenna filiform, okay, they are thread like pronotum with large descending lateral lobes. Okay, so what it means, so you know the cockroach pronotum, for example, it is shield shaped, you know, it is flat, whereas here in this case, in case of Orthoptera, this pronotum is descended laterally, so it extends like this, laterally it is projected, you can see here. So that is a very important character of order Orthoptera. Okay, and it also covers, this pronotum also covers mesonotum and metanotum. That means the pronotum is much larger, which covers the mesonotum and metanotum. And hind legs are saltatorian type. That means the femur is enlarged and modified for jumping purpose. And generally, we'll find the winged insects, whereas few insect species are wingless. Okay, under this Orthoptera, you can see here. So wingless insect and most of the other winged groups. Few more important characters of Orthoptera includes four wings are elongate, leathery, which is called tegmina. So four wings of grasshoppers, okay, Orthoptera are called tegmina, whereas hind wings are membranous. Okay, so only hind wings are used for flight and four wings are used for protecting the hind wings. Okay, they are membranous. You can very clearly see the hind wings are so large. And it will be folded, okay, it will be folded and placed behind the forewings. Okay, they are broad and folded fan-wise. Okay. Other important character includes stridulatory organs. Sound producing mechanism is very well developed in case of most of the species of Orthoptera. And wherever, whichever the species where sound production is very well developed, auditory organs, that means the listening organs, auditory organs are also well developed. So sound production is usually by rubbing the wings together, okay, that's called Ehlers type, or the hind legs and the forewings together. It's called femoro-Ehlers type. So sound production is Ehlers or femoro-Ehlers. So this we already studied in the communication class. So one structure acts as peg and other structure acts as scraper. And when the two structures are actually rubbed together, okay, sound is produced. It may be hind leg and the forewing or the both the forewings. Okay, so that's how the wing production occurs. So this is a comparatively big order, ENS. Okay, so this order is divided into two suborders. suborder Ensifera and suborder Coelifera. Okay, so listen to my pronunciation as well. Okay, so if you pronounce it improperly, that's when you are writing, the spelling mistake may also happen. So that's why the pronunciation of the order name or the scientific names or the family names are very much important. Okay, Ensifera and Coelifera. So Ensifera includes long-arm grasshoppers, crickets and mole crickets, whereas Coelifera includes short-arm grasshoppers, so grouse locusts, pygmy mole crickets. Okay, so long arm, the length of the antenna actually matters a lot. Okay, so Ensifera means antenna with well over 30 segments, so about as long as or longer than the body. So the antenna is much longer. That's why you can see long arm grasshoppers, Ensifera. Whereas in case of Coelifera, antenna with less than 30 segments, okay, and shorter than the half the length of the body. Okay, so it is not the length actually very important, although the length, by looking at the specimen, you can say whether it is actually Ensifera and Coelifera. The number of segments are actually very much important. So more than 30 segments in Ensifera, less than 30 segments in case of Coelifera. Other important character includes tympanal organs when present, they are present on 4 tibia in case of Ensifera, whereas the tympanal organs when present, they are present on the abdomen, especially on the sides of first abdominal segment in case of Coelifera. Ovipositor, when present, they are actually sword-like or stiletto form. They are sharp, elongated, sword-like in Ensifera. Whereas in case of Coelifera, ovipositor is short and robust, horny, very hard in fact. Ensifera, sound produced usually by rubbing the forewings together. That means Ehlers type. Whereas in case of Coelifera, it is femoro-Ehlers type. Okay, so we'll take one by one each of these characters so that you will be better understand the differences. Yeah, so Ensifera includes long-arm grasshoppers, crickets, okay, so and mole crickets. So you can see here the length of the antenna in case of mole cricket looks shorter, but the number of antenna segments actually matters, more than 30 segments. So in Coelifera includes short-arm grasshoppers, grouse locusts, okay, pygmy mole crickets, which includes locusts as well. You can see the length of the antenna is short. Okay, yeah. So antenna with well over 30 segments, longer, whereas here in this case, antenna is less than 30 segments, usually shorter than the half the length of the body. Okay, that's how we can distinguish these two suborders. So tympanal organs, when present, they are present on the 4 tibia. Okay, you can see here the tympanal organ, the membrane structure, okay, artery organ. Whereas in case of Coelifera, it is present on the first abdominal segment. So that's how we can differentiate these two suborders. Similarly, sound production is Ehlers type. Okay, in case of crickets, long-arm grasshoppers, catenids, both the forewings are actually rubbed together and sound is produced. Whereas in case of Coelifera, it includes short-arm grasshoppers, locusts. Okay, so femoro Ehlers type of stridulation. So forewing and the hind femur is used to rub and the sound is produced. Okay, so looking at the character, so how actually the sound is produced. So in case of Ensifera, you can see here both the forewings are actually rubbed together and sound is produced. You can see the movement there. Okay, so one axis peg and another axis file and another axis scraper, in fact, file and scraper. So as a result of that, sound is produced. Okay, whereas in case of, you can see here, so wings are used. Whereas in case of short-arm grasshopper, for example, you can see here the hind leg movement, which will be axis file and the forming acts as a scraper. Okay, as a result, sound is produced. Okay, femur of hind leg and the wing. Femoro Ehlers type. Ehlers means wing. So that's how the sound production occurs. So that's how we can differentiate the order suborder Ensifera and suborder Coelifera. Okay, so these are the, maybe with a single character, you should be able to remember the characters of two suborders. That's how it becomes very easy, in fact. Yeah, so in case of Ensifera, ovipositor, when present, it is sword-like, okay, or stiletto form, which is long, elongated. Okay. Whereas in case of Coelifera, ovipositor is short and robust, horny. Okay. With the help of this, actually tick the soil and lay the eggs inside. So, locusts and grasshoppers. Whereas in case of crickets and tetigonids, okay, long-arm grasshoppers. So, eggs are laid or inserted into the plant parts between the leaf lamina or sometimes the crickets, for example, eggs are deposited into the soil. Okay, so that's how structurally these ovipositors are modified. So coming to the economically important families under these two suborders. Okay, so suborder Ensifera. Of course, we have a number of other families as well. So these are the few families which are very prevalent, very common in Indian condition. So I'll be covering only few of the families which are very common and economically important. Okay, Tetigonidae, which includes long-arm grasshoppers. Grillidae, crickets. Grillotapidae, more crickets. Okay, these are the two Ensiferum families we'll be concentrating. In case of Coelifera, Acridae, that includes chaton grasshoppers and locusts. Phirgomarchidae, which are commonly called gaudy grasshoppers. Okay, we'll take one by one. Okay, suborder Ensifera, Tetigonidae family. Okay, long arm grasshoppers. Okay, which are now important characters of this family are usually they are greenish. Color is not a taxonomic character. Okay, so try to concentrate on very important characters which distinguishes from other families or other genus, other subfamily like that. Okay, tarsi is four segmented. Okay, tarsi is four segmented and ovipositor is sword like. Okay, eggs are deposited in tissues or some, say for example, other, in case of other families, say for example, grillids, okay, where the eggs are deposited inside. So that's how we can see why these structures are variously modified. Okay, so like eggs are laid in plant tissue. So tarsi is four segmented, long arm grasshoppers. Literally, you can see this long arm like antenna. There we can say that these are actually belongs to family Tetigonidae. So few of the species which are belongs to this family: Macropoda elongata, very common; Phonocephalus melanus; Phonocephalus maculatus; Sartorella rugosa, which usually found on the tree trunks, so camouflaged. Coming to second family, Grillidae. They are actually crickets. There is a mistake here. Somewhat flattened insects. Tarsi is three segmented. Okay, so in case of Tetigonidae, tarsi is four segmented. Whereas here the ovipositor is elongate. Okay, cylindrical. Eggs are laid inside. Okay, ovipositor is long, elongate. And sarsi are feeler like antenna only. They are elongated. They are long in fact. Okay, so that's how we can differentiate the Tetigonidae. They are called long-arm grasshoppers. Grillidae, which are called crickets. Okay, there is a spelling mistake. So we don't get confused. Okay, few of the species under this Grillidae are house cricket, Brachytrops portentus, tree cricket, Eucanthus indicus, field cricket, Grillus campestris. Okay, how do you distinguish these two families? Tarsi four segmented and tarsi three segmented. Ovipositor is four like, whereas here it is elongated. That's how we can differentiate family Tetigonidae and Grillidae. Grillotapidae, they are commonly called mole crickets. Very common. You might have seen, especially where there will be a dampness there. Usually they access scavenger sense. They are very common there. Eyes are reduced. They are blind. Four legs. They are expanded. Okay. Armed with strong teeth. Okay. Assist in digging. Okay. Especially they live in moist soil and they dig soil. Okay. They live in inside. They access scavengers in fact. Ovipositor is vestigial. Okay. In the previous two families, it is variously modified. Here you can see it is vestigial. Vestigial means underdeveloped. So not very clear character in fact. Tegmina, short, covering only the half of the abdomen. You can see here. Okay, only it's not completely covers the abdomen. Tarsi again are feeler like. Okay, so these are the important characters of order family Grillotapidae. They are commonly called mole cricket. Coming to second suborder Coelifera, wherein we will be concentrating on two families, family Acridae and Phirgomarchidae. So Acridates are commonly called short arm grasshoppers, which also includes locusts. Very important. So important characters includes tarsi three segmented, fastigial furrow is absent. I will show that character where actually we should look for this fastigial. Fastigial means sepalum, that means head. Okay, furrow means actually a line, which is absent. So that means we have another family called Phirgomarchidae where it is present. Stridulatory or sound production organs are very well developed. So which is usually femoro-ellary type. In case of Ensifera it is ellary type, whereas in case of Coelifera it is femoro-ellary type. Pronotum is saddle shaped. Okay, hind legs again they are modified for jumping purpose. So the important species includes locusts. Okay, Cystocerca gregaria. We are hearing this Cystocerca gregaria, the name a lot since few months in India. Nomadacris sancicta, Locusta migratoria. Few of the other grasshoppers includes Aeroglypus banyan, Aeroglypus nigro repletus, Axia velax, Axia nitidula. Cotton grasshoppers, Cytocanthacris tartarica. These are a few species. Actually, there are a number of species described under this family Acridae. Okay, so very important thing to be remembered is that so few of the grasshoppers, in fact, at times, whenever the environmental conditions are very favorable, they turn into locusts. Okay, what are these locusts, in fact? Okay, so these locusts are grasshoppers. Okay, so when the environmental stimuli, when the conditions are very congenial for their multiplication, so these grasshoppers, which usually we will find in isolated, in a solitary manner, one individual. At times, they become, you know, multiplied in enormous number, and they, you know, move in swarms, causing enormous losses in agriculture. Okay, they are called actually locusts. So few of the important species of locusts which are found, you know, in few localities of India are desert locust, Cystocerca gregaria, which are found in Asia, Africa, and even parts of Europe. Bombay locust, which is called Patanga sancita, so synonymous name is Hemadacris sancita, found in Indian Peninsula, okay, which is not common nowadays. So now its outbreak is mostly confined to few islands of Lakshadweep. Another species is Indian migratory locust, Locusta migratoria, migratoriates, okay, found throughout India. Of course, there are few other locusts. So locusts are grasshoppers, and they become very problematic in few parts of the world and considered as very serious pests of, you know, crops. Okay, so you can see here, now there is a color morphism. There will be change in coloration when they turn from solitary phase to migratory phase. You can see here, this is now green and they turn into brown after. Okay, and also the not just the coloration, there are various characteristic changes. Okay, this type of morphological change, okay, from okay individual phase, which is called phase solitaria, to, you know, congregated phase, which is called phase gregaria, is called kentromorphism. Okay, what is this kentromorphism? We'll study. So kentromorphism is a type of polyphenism in response to population density, okay, triggered by environmental stimuli. So that means the change in the morphological structures occurs because of increase in the population density. Change in the population density, this population density change occurs because of the variation in the environmental stimuli. Okay, so what is this? No, two changes which occurs, okay, in case of locusts. One form, which I was telling that, is actually phase solitaria, and another phase is phase gregaria. One is actually, you know, referred by low density population, whereas the other is actually refers to high density. Okay, the low and high density phases of locusts are respectively called phase solitaria and phase gregaria. Okay, so the two phases differ from one another in coloration pattern in at least immature stages, the young ones, juveniles, okay, nymphs, and also in anatomical proportions, physiology and behavior. Okay, the length, size, coloration, all actually changes when they turn into, okay, gregarious phase from solitary phase. Okay, or either way. You can see, I'm taking an example from Cystocerca gregaria, which is very serious pest in Africa and India and parts of Europe as well. So in case of solitary phase, when they are found in individual solitary manner, the solitary phase is, nymphs are greenish in color. Okay, you can see the early instars. While older adults turn grayish. Okay, they'll be in greenish form in the early instars. They later actually turns greenish. Okay, whereas in case of phase gregaria, the body is pinkish. You can see here with pink coloration and a pattern with lot of black coloration. Okay, whereas the adults actually turns to yellow. Okay, so that is the difference between phase solitaria and phase gregaria. Another very important characterial difference we can recognize between phase solitaria and phase gregaria is that pronotum is longer. Okay, pronotum is longer, crested with a long femur. Okay, pronotum is long, crested, and also you will find the long femur. Whereas here you can see the pronotum is shorter, saddle shaped. Okay, and femur length is actually shorter. Okay, that's how we can differentiate the phase solitary and phase gregaria. Okay, so this phenomenon is common in locusts. That means only in few, no, species of orthopterans, but it is also found in phasmids, that includes stick insects, and some species of lepidopteran larvae, which includes armyworms. Okay, therein we will find the solitary phase where it is represented by, no, individuals. Okay, generally when you go for collection, you will find the individual grasshoppers, but when they are found in millions, it is called gregarious phase. So maybe you'll better understand when you see some of the pictures where you will find the millions of grasshoppers. Okay, so locusts differ from other grasshoppers in their ability to change from solitary living form into gregarious, highly mobile adult forms and upper bands, which are called upper bands when they are moving in large number, as their numbers and densities increase. Okay, they exist in different states known as recession with low and intermediate numbers. Very few numbers will be there. That's called recession period, few numbers. But at times when the environmental conditions are actually congenial, which rise to outbreak farms, wherein there will be extremely high population is maintained. Okay, there will be population increase, which is called phase gregaria. Okay, you can see here, the millions of such grasshoppers actually move in large number, and they feed on whatever the green thing which actually comes to there, and that will be eaten. As a result, they act as very serious pests. So this is the example of desert locust Cystocerca urticaria. You can see here, it's called swarm plague. Okay, upper bands, so moves in millions and causes enormous loss. Okay, so this Cystocerca urticaria is very problematic pest. Now, in North Africa, parts of Europe, as well as Asia, including parts of India. Especially in this year, we encounter very serious problem of outbreak of Cystocerca urticaria. And till today, we are experiencing serious problem, and even governmental agencies are struggling to contain the pest movement. The Nomadacris sensita, another one, which is found in India and also Southeast Asian countries. And Locusta migratoria, you can see here, found in many parts of the world. So most of these locusts are actually multinational pests, okay, highly cosmopolitan, okay, as they are found in different countries. Okay, so international collaboration is required to contain this pest movement and reduce the loss. Okay, that's why they're called, transboundary pests. Okay, very important. Okay, so locusts are one of the worst transboundary pests and attracted a lot of attention of entomologists. In fact, why this, what are important congenital conditions which are responsible for increasing the population? Why this movement occurs? What actually triggers this population buildup and all? And a lot of research is actually going on. Okay, I'll not get into that. I'll restrict to most of the taxonomic aspects only. The next family which we are interested is Phrygomorphidae, which are commonly called gaudy grasshoppers. Okay, so the difference between Acridiidae and Phrygomorphidae is that their fastigial furrow is absent, here fastigial furrow is present. What is this actually? You can see here, this is the fastigial furrow. The furrow is a line found in the head region, so which is present only in Phrygomorphidae but not in Acridiidae. Okay, so most of these Phrygomorphids are highly colorful, but which is not so in all the time. So that's why this taxonomic character actually very helpful in order to distinguish. So sound producing organs are vestigial. So in case of Acridids, the femoral LIV type of stridulation will be there, but not in case of Phrygomorphidae. So that's how we can distinguish. So few important species are Deccan wingless grasshopper, Polymania spenariates. You heard of Dr. L.C. Coleman. In order to ever remember his contribution to entomology, so the genus Polymania was actually erected by I. Bolivar, a taxonomist in fact. So this Polymania spenariates is very common in parts of South India. Surface grasshopper, Crotogonus trachypterus. Okay, so this is the species which is very common, especially on grass. AKR Ekka grasshopper, Pycheloceras pictus. So you can look for this fastigial furrow. Okay, so which is absent in case of Acridiidae. So that's how we can distinguish Acridiidae and Phrygomorphidae. You can look for this character where this line is present, it will go to Phrygomorphidae. So sound production mechanism is well developed in case of Acridiidae, whereas in case of Phrygomorphidae, it is vestigial. So not so well developed. That's how we can distinguish. So few important species are Alarcus species. One species is there which is called Alarcus miliaris, which is called coffee locust. Occurs in large numbers on coffee and other plantation in South India. But it is not a locust like Cystocerca urticaria and will not cause such serious losses. Pycheloceras pictus is the Ekka grasshopper you'll find on the calotropis plants, especially Alarcus miliaris, Phrygomorpha species especially. Okay, so these are the few representative species under this family Phrygomorphidae. Okay, coming to habitat and habitat, as I was mentioning, they are there itself. Okay, so most of these orthopterans are plant feeders. They are phytophagous. Thereby, some of them, especially locusts, become serious pests of our crops. Whereas few species are predaceous, carnivorous. Like one family is there, which is called Cyzodactylidae in India, especially in northern India. Wherein you can see the forewings are actually bent upwards like this, which is called scientific name of this species is Cyzodactylus monostrosus, which I'm not covering here. It's not an economically important family, in fact. So, few examples. It is a predaceous. Few are scavengers, which we already studied, the grillo talpidae, okay, more crickets. And few are more or less omnivorous, feed on many things. So, how do you collect and preserve the orthopterans? Collected with a sweep net, either by sweeping the vegetation so that randomly you get a lot of other species, or by aiming at a particular individual. If you find any grasshopper, you can go behind that and sweep and collect that grasshopper. Some hiding secretive species can be collected at night by listening their sounds. Especially at home, you may encounter this sounds of crickets. Okay, so probably you can, without disturbance, you can go and collect such specimens.
So preservation is also important. It has to be pinned. The artha protuberance has to be pinned through the right side of rear part of pronotum. Okay, you can see here, this is the pronotum, which covers the mesonotum and metanotum, rear part, almost at the posterior end, the pin has to be inserted and appendages needs to be properly stretched. Okay, so usually the wings are need not to stretch, but especially for now taxonomic purpose, the either one side of the wing has to be stretched, so that especially in case of hind wings, so this venation will become very clear, so that the taxonomic identification can be attempted. Okay, so these are it has to be, so orthopterans has to be collected and preserved. So about 23,830 species have been described worldwide, and from India 1,033 species. Okay, few questions. Meaning of all locusts are grasshoppers, but not all grasshoppers are locusts. Okay, so remember, locusts are grasshoppers, but not all grasshoppers do not have the ability to become locusts. Okay, so if you are confused, go through 2-3 times, definitely you will understand the meaning of it. Distinguishing character of Acridiidae and Phrygomorphidae, I was telling about this vestigial furrow that we can recognize. Distinguishing character of Ensifera and Coelifera, two suborders of Arthoptera. Type of leg in mole cricket, okay, especially the four leg I am talking about, they are actually burrowing type, digitate, okay, helpful for digging. Whereas the hind legs of most of the other grasshoppers are meant for a saltatorian type, okay, for jumping. Very importantly, okay, even though grasshoppers are, as I was telling, very serious pests, many parts of the world actually now they will be utilized as now dietary components as food, like this, now these two pictures. Thereby you can acquire a lot of proteinaceous food. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can post below or you can email me as well. Thank you very much.